You're listening to The Other 50%, A History of Hollywood. I'm Julie Harris Walker. This is the podcast where I talk to successful women in entertainment and hear their stories. For this episode, I spoke with a producer and two stars of Jim Cummings' much-anticipated new film, The Wolf of Snow Hollow, which opens October 9th in theaters around the country and streaming in the comfort of your living room. Natalie Metzger, whom you will remember from an earlier episode of this podcast, produced this movie under her shingle Vanishing Angle, where she also produced Jim Cummings' Thunder Road that won the South by Southwest Grand Jury Award, along with about a million other awards. Riki Lindhome plays Officer Julia Robson in the film. You may also know her from Duncanville, Knives Out, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, and the comedy musical duo Garfunkel and Oates, just to name a few. And finally, we also have Chloe East, who played the role of Jenna Marshall in the film. Chloe made her TV debut in True Blood, playing Sheriff Andy's daughter. Lately, she has been shooting Generation for HBO, Next Level, and Kevin Probably Saves the World. Natalie, Riki, and Chloe join me from three different locations in this time of COVID, so the audio is what it is, but have a listen to what it takes to actually make a film in tricky conditions and how it is to work with Jim Cummings. Then go out or order in and see this film tomorrow. You can find us at theother50percent.com for added features, photos, show notes, and the merchandise. You can also listen on Apple Podcasts and all the podcast places. Okay, here's my conversation with Natalie Metzger, Riki Lindhome, and Chloe East. Have a listen. I am here with some of the cast and the producer of The Wolf of Snow Hollow, which is opening Friday, October 9th. Let's have everyone say hello so that we know your voices. Natalie, you've been on the show before, so people may recognize you and remember you, but say hi.
Hello, everyone. This is Natalie.
And Riki, why don't you say hello?
Hi, I'm Riki Lindhome. What's up?
And Chloe?
Hello, it's Chloe.
So, hi, guys. I was looking at the trailer, and the movie looks both very scary and very funny. Natalie, you want to give us kind of the elevator pitch?
Sure, yeah. So, this is Jim Cummings' follow-up to Thunder Road, which won the grand jury at South by Southwest. And so, this is his second feature. And it follows a small-town mountain cop who starts trying to solve a murder. And as he progresses through trying to solve it, more murders start happening. They all start happening on the full moon. He tries to convince himself and the town that it's not a werewolf.
In the trailer, he seems very insistent that it's absolutely not a werewolf. And it seems very obvious that, of course, it's a werewolf.
You never know. You got to watch it.
Okay, I'm jumping to conclusions. I don't know what happens. Riki, let's talk about your part in it.
Okay. Well, first of all, I'm brunette, which was crazy.
Because, yeah, you don't look brunette. I'm looking at you. You look
no, brown. I was for the thing. They called me, I think it was last March, right, Natalie?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I got a call and I maybe had like 3 or 4 days before I had to leave for Utah. And so I talked to Jim and I talked to Matt. I don't think I talked to Natalie. I talked to Matt, the producer, Matt Miller, and I talked to Jim. And they're like, do you want to come to Utah and do this? And I was like, hell yeah. And they said, will you dye your hair brown? And I was like, okay. But I did. They gave me the exact picture. So it was good because I was like, there's lots of brown. And so they sent me an exact picture and I was like, great. So I went to the salon, got it done. And then, yeah, and it was fun. I played like a subtler character than I'm used to playing. Like, she's not goofy. She's just like kind of a straight man. She's a cop.
So how was that?
It was fun. It was cool. It was fun. I don't know. I liked it.
And she's so good in it. Like, she plays this, she's this like badass cop that like she's surrounded by idiots and she's the one that's like smart and on top of it and actually gets the job done. And so it's really cool to see her play this kind of straight man character against like the crazy people that are part of this sheriff's department, including, you know, the character that Jim Cummings plays.
Mm-hmm. Of course, it's the woman who's going to be completely competent and get the job done while everyone's bumbling around her.
I know, that never happens. That's so weird.
That's so weird.
Can you believe I was an overlooked competent woman? I can't imagine that actually happening. That's why it's a movie.
But in a movie? Yeah, you never see that. Chloe, let's talk about your part.
I play Jenna Marshall, John Marshall's daughter, which is Jim Cummings' character, who wrote it, directed it, as maybe most people who are listening to this podcast know. Yeah, I play a very angsty, stereotypical teenager. You get what you get. Not too new for my range of acting roles, but I play that a lot. But yeah, and John is kind of thrown into this crazy head that John is dealing with a million different things, and it's now this wolf, werewolf, whoever, whatever it is. And it's Jenna trying to find out if he's crazy, what's going on, if it's real, if it's not real. And yeah, me and Riki lived together during the
show. It was so fun. So
much fun.
Yeah.
Riki was a whole nother gal. She had an accent, brown hair.
I was like going through stuff. It was a time. But I moved in with Chloe and her mom, Amy, and we had the best time. They were like, you're going to live with this teenager and her mom. And I'm like, what? And then I got there and I'm like, oh, this is my dream. Like, it was like a month long slumber party. We got along literally the day we met. It was like, oh, this is okay. Yeah, this is great. And then every single night we like gabbed and had dinner and cooked. Well, Chloe's this amazing cook. Or we went out to dinner, whatever it was. We
was
just
your
like,
birthday too.
It was my birthday. I still wear the birthday socks you bought me.
Hey! All the
time. We had the best time. We lived in this like gorgeous like ski cabin. I felt bad because I saw where production was living and you guys were like smushed into this teeny tiny house and there was like 40 of you. And then there's three of us in this chalet where we're like,
beautiful bathtub, just the biggest stone bathtub that you've ever seen. It was just luxury to its finest.
Was this contractual? Because these guys are in bunk beds.
Yeah, we had one of our producers, the production designer, and several other actors in bunk beds in this like very small Airbnb. One of the producers was like sleeping on the floor in like one of the closets. It was very, you know, we were making it work. But you know, when you're shooting in a very rural part of Utah, there weren't a lot of hotel options. And obviously, when you're bringing in cast from Los Angeles and like you want to put them up in a nice hotel, but there literally wasn't one nearby. And so
there's no Four Seasons.
Yeah. And so we're like, okay, well, the best we can do is to like, you know, get this, you know, this Airbnb that, you know, I mean, we try to find like, you know, a really nice one, but it was this weird thing of being, you know, having to go to the actors and say, okay, you're going to have to share this house. It's a really nice house and you'll each have like kind of your own space, but you will have to share a house with, you know, two other people. But we were so glad that we all got along. And then we became jealous because we would hear about Chloe's cooking and we would desperately want to partake. And so it was great to hear all the
We were in like a ski chalet that's like glass everywhere and huge bathtubs. And yeah.
You're like knocking on the door at 6 o'clock. Like, I have your call sheet. Right. What are you guys doing?
No, it was this snowy wonderland. Initially, I was like, hell no, I'm not being in a shared house. I like just didn't like the whole, I didn't know what it looked like. I didn't know anything about it. And then I was sent the Airbnb link and I'm like, oh my, this is beautiful. I still look for that Airbnb today. I want to stay in that Airbnb again. It was amazing. It was in the middle of nowhere in Camas, but it was great. And it was such a good time.
The only bad thing was you couldn't even get like a pizza. You couldn't get an Uber. It was just so in the middle of a ski town where it was like, you gotta like, it's good. It's good. I was living with a chef.
Yeah. It was a gated community. And just like from the gate to the house, I think was like a 5 to 10 minute drive. It was very high up on the mountain. It means it was a beautiful view, but it was like a bit of a trek to get in or out.
How long was the shoot?
It was 23 days. And I was going to note something for Chloe. So, you know, she has a background as a dancer, which is, you know, very unique. And she actually did all of her own stunts, which there were a lot of stunts for her role. So it was cool to like see her, you know, jump into that and to be able to be like, oh yeah, you need me to like roll over and fall out of this thing and like do it all like really gracefully. No big deal.
Very cool. Now, Chloe, I was checking out your IMDb and it looks like you've been acting basically since the day you were born. Is that accurate?
Yeah, up until I was 12 or 13, I was very focused on dance, but still at the same time, I was doing all the school plays and was getting into it a little bit through dancing too, because I got a dance agent and I auditioned for dance jobs, which were just like crappy low paid dance commercials, but I had to act a little bit in it. And I made my transition to acting after being with a dance agent for a couple years, just because I wanted to see what would happen. And I just got more and more into acting. But yeah, it's weird to think like I was a child actor. I think back at it now, I'm like, I was that like weird child, homeschool child actor. That was me. But I never thought of it like when I was doing it, when I was in it, I was just doing it for fun and thought it was kind of a normal thing to do. You know, you like something and you do it, but it is weird to look back and like, I just wanted to be a star. I wanted to.
You look back and realize like, that's not everybody's normal life. And you probably thought, oh, this is just what we do.
True. Somewhat. Yeah.
Did you grow up in LA?
I grew up in San Clemente, which is like, it's where I am right now, actually. It's a beautiful, quaint little beach town, an hour and a half from LA, but I moved to LA 7 years ago when I was doing a movie and the commute was just too much. So I just ended up moving up.
And it looks like you were in True Blood.
True. I was still living in San Clemente at that time. But yeah, that was like my first legit. I mean, I did like a Lifetime movie before that, but it was like my first legit job where I realized that craft service was more than crackers on the table and was like anything you could possibly want in life.
So at that point, were you like, that's it, I'm in, this is what I'm doing?
I don't know if I had a moment where I was like, this is what I'm doing, this is it. But it was just something that I just kept doing. And I just kept auditioning and kept doing the thing. And just more and more, I just got lucky, I think. I think I just got lucky doing it from a young age too. People ask me all the time, like, how do I get into acting? How do I jump in? How do I get an agent? And I don't know. Like, I don't know the answers. I just started young and got lucky. And I'm super fortunate and super grateful.
You can say that to them. That's really encouraging. You're like, start 10 years ago and get lucky.
Like, I am so sorry. It's the worst answer ever. But I don't know. Like, if you're super passionate about something and you like doing it, I would say do it for what you like it for. And then anything else that comes after that is great. For a long time, I was like, the audition is the job. Like, that is, if anything else happens after that, then great. But having the mentality that like, oh, I have to get the next job, or I have to get the next thing, or I have to work to be successful, that can get a little dicey and heady. But I don't know. I was just super content and just got lucky, I think. Honestly, that's my truthful answer.
I mean, that does seem like the right attitude. Otherwise, I think it could just make you crazy.
I know.
Riki.
Yes.
I want to talk about how you started in your career, because I know you're an actor, but you're also a writer. But honestly, could we just talk about Gilmore Girls?
Yes.
I mean,
yeah.
Just give me just a little Gilmore Girl tidbit, and then we can talk about other things. But
so mine was kind of the opposite of Chloe, where I didn't start late. I was 21. That's not really like that late. But I probably didn't have an agent for the first 5 years of my career, maybe longer. And I got Gilmore Girls from doing one of those casting director workshops that they
remember those
legal for whatever reason. Like, I honestly don't even understand. Like, it's like, it was because I'm from a town of 1,000 people and I didn't know anyone. And everyone's like, you shouldn't have to pay to audition. And I'm like, yeah, but I'd rather give $25 than never get any auditions. Like, I didn't know any people. It was just so daunting. And I got to meet every big casting director. And I auditioned for the Gilmore Girls casting directors and they gave me a part as a high schooler. And then a year or two later, they just brought me back as a different part. And then I was one of Rory's classmates at Yale. But the funny thing about that is I remember when I auditioned, the casting director sent either an email or called and they were like, just talk really fast. They were like, you talk really fast. That's why you're right for the show. Talk faster than even normal. And I'm like, okay. So they liked when I auditioned, they're like, you talk really fast. This is great. And they're like, double it. And then I talked really fast in the audition and they're like, that's great. And then same thing happened at the second one.
I mean, that's the secret sauce. Do they just shoot faster than anything on that show?
Well, I don't totally, but I feel like the scripts were like 90 pages for like a 60-minute show. It was just so many words and you just have to be able to talk fast. And I was like, oh, I can do that. And then they brought me back again. So
that's so fun. And then when did you start writing?
I started writing probably when I was like 23 or 24, but in just a very minor way. Like, I tried to do some, it's just like what, like, I was trying, but not really, because I had a day job. And so I was acting and I was a waitress. And anyone who does that knows, like, you're just like exhausted. I was too tired. And so I would try to get stuff done, but it was just a slow, it would take me a really long time. And I thought I was lazy when I didn't know that I was just tired and that I didn't know my own creative process. Like, I didn't know that I write so much better in the morning. Like I would waitress and then come home and try to write something. And I didn't, and I thought I was lazy and couldn't make it work when I didn't know that I should have just gone to bed and woken up early and tried to write. Like I had to figure all that out. But I started seriously writing when I was maybe 27 or 28, when I started doing Garfunkel and Oates. And that was just like, the world just kind of opened up to me in a way that it really hadn't before. And I was like, well, I've got to follow this path. Because before that, it just felt like, no, 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 no. And then I started writing and it felt like there was just like, yeses. And I'm like, wait, what do you, what? Okay. And so I just kept doing that.
And can we talk a little bit about your theater too? Because you're part of the Actors Gang.
I was. I haven't done it in so long. So I was in Embedded, which you know about because your friend was in that as well with me. So I did.
Yeah, Kylie Hollister, who was on the podcast, also told us all about the Embedded journey.
Yep, I did Embedded. It was a play that was supposed to run for four performances, like midnight performances on Friday and Saturday of 2 weeks in the small Actors Gang, which was 25 seat theater. And it ended up going for like 2 years. And we went to New York and we went to London. I got into Actors Equity. Like it was a whole thing. It was Tim Robbins wrote and directed it and was in it. And it just ended up being this whole crazy journey that really like it, my career took off like after that took off. I mean, it's still like another 3 years before I got an agent. I shouldn't say took off. But Clint Eastwood came to see the play and I got my first movie, which was Million Dollar Baby, which obviously is a crazy first movie to be in. And yeah, it was just like, that was sort of the beginning of everything for me. But I don't think I've done a play since. And I stopped doing the Actors Gang. This was interesting. It was like 5 or 6 years later and I didn't get into, I was auditioned for some play and I like kind of thought I should get it because we all auditioned in front of each other and I didn't get it. And I was like, okay, well, I'm going to get their rehearsal schedule and I'm going to work during their rehearsal schedule. So I was like, if I can be at rehearsal from 6 to 10, I can be like learning how to do something else from 6 to 10. And I decided to make a short. And during whatever hours I would have been at rehearsal, including the drive time, I like read books about lighting and whatever. And then I directed my first short the opening weekend of that play that I didn't get. And then I just kind of never went back.
Oh my God.
That's amazing.
I would have spent all this time anyway. It's just hard to make your own schedule. And it was right around the time when I didn't need to waitress anymore because I was doing a lot of commercials and I was super thankful for that. And I'm like, well, I'm just going to use this as my schedule.
That's amazing.
Wasn't that a good idea? Like, because like it's so hard to discipline yourself. And I was like, well, I would do it if someone else told me to be there. So why can't I do that for myself?
Like, I'm speechless. No, that was a good idea.
Yeah. I was like, can you guys send me the rehearsal schedule for this play? And they were like, I guess.
Okay.
I just had the calendar and I just followed it. And I just was like, I would have left it this time. And So
you wrote a short or you shot a short
wrote a short and then direct and like produced it and did everything and directed it on opening weekend of that play and then edited it during the run of the play. And so during the time I would have been doing that, I made my first thing.
Okay. So you're also a producer and a director. You do all the things.
Yeah, I try to.
She's the quintuple threat.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, that's my license plate, actually. I'm just kidding.
Okay. Do you also sing?
Yeah. Well, I have Garfunkel and Oates. So I have a comedy band and it's me and this other girl, Kate Micucci, and we do comedy songs. And so that like, that was the thing when I said I really started writing, it was for that.
Julie, you have to listen to them. They're incredible. It is like, they're so smart and funny and like, and also just like really musically talented as well. But like beyond that, like, it's just, these like songs are just, they touch on some of the most important like issues and just things that like people think about or that like happen to women, and they like turn it into these like funny songs, and it's just you will love it.
Oh, thanks. We're a highly feminist band.
I love it. I also see they did Crazy Ex-Girlfriend and also New Girl, like all my favorite shows.
Yeah, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend I got because, you know, Rachel also does comedy music, so there's not very many of them. And so that's how I ended up doing that. I played a sex-starved cat. It was like a parody of Cats. And I was like the one who was like wanting to, you know, get some from another cat, I guess. I don't know. It was my first professional dance scene.
That's so great.
I'm not a dancer like Chloe, but I'm an enthusiastic mover.
You're an actress who sings and moves well?
I move well. Yeah, I can move on a beat, but I'm not like Chloe, but I can move enough.
Did you guys do any choreography in The Wolf of Snow Hollow?
Unfortunately not. I don't think either of us are on TikTok, but if we were, we probably would have made a lot of TikToks together. I'm just in the world of if.
Garfunkel and Oates, there's like a thing. Somebody showed me this. I don't know if you've seen this on my Instagram, Chloe, but like people have we have this song called The Loophole. Which is a very dirty song. And there's a TikTok.
Incredible.
Kids are like showing the loophole to their parents and just filming their reaction. And it makes me laugh so hard. I just can't handle it.
I'm going to ask my kids. They're on TikTok, I think 23 hours a day.
Yeah.
Natalie, let's go back to the movie. I'm wondering if there are some stories from the production of the movie that these guys don't even know about because you kept it from them. So they had a beautiful experience. Well, there were fires that you were putting out.
Well, yeah. I mean, there are always, I think, fires that producers are putting out and trying to make sure that the director and the cast have their space and like a bubble to be actually able to do the creative. This was an interesting endeavor, not unlike others that we've done before, but is because Jim is the writer, director, and also the star of the film. And so I think it's always interesting to see new people brought in to like work with Jim, just because Jim has such a particular way of working. And I'm sure Riki and Chloe, you can each, you know, speak to it, but you know, it's like, he has this crazy energy and he's, you know, jumping around and he swaps hats kind of without any kind of like notice of change. And so he'll go from like acting and like giving what the line will be to then like running around and saying, and camera's going to be here and it's going to be on a 50 millimeter lens and we're going to push in like slowly like here. And then he'll like literally run to the other side of the room and then be the actor and then like say the line and then run back and be like, and then camera's going to be moving around like this. And so it's, it can be very overwhelming for people when
not only that, but he can also do, this is the craziest. So he'll be like, you know, so push in like this, go like this, ready and action. And then he'll cry. He doesn't even need a minute. He can just like, he'll just start. If he has the cry, he can just, he'll be like, Riki, you're standing there. You're doing this, blah, blah, blah. Lights here, ready and action. And I'm like, whoa.
It's so fast. Really fast. It happens very fast. Your brain has to be on. You have to be ready for it.
Okay. He sounds like some kind of like crazy genius.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's very much it. But yeah, I think most of the like production challenges were related to snow. So, you know, the whole thing is supposed to take place in a snowy town. It's a ski town. We shot outside of Park City in the towns of Camas and Colville. And we shot during the winter and there was, you know, a bunch of snow on the ground, which was great. And then there was one day that we were filming at this one house. And the house was like kind of up this hill and it wasn't a paved road to get up there. And it started snowing on the day of, and it got, so like the road got really, really slushy. We couldn't get cars up and down and there was supposed to be,
I remember that day.
Yeah. It was like the day when like, it was like the cops examining this murder scene. And so we had all these cop cars and all these people and like the cop car kept on getting stuck and Matt Miller and Ben Wiesner were like trying to like maneuver it. And like, I was trying to like push it. And it was a lot of, you know, moving around in the slush. And I think the day before that, we had a scene, Riki and Chloe, you guys weren't there for this, but it was Annie and Jimmy's scene in the hot tub. And we had bought this hot tub because so Jim picked out a location that was beautiful and had this beautiful backdrop, but it didn't have a built-in hot tub. And there's this whole scene that has to happen in a hot tub at this location. And so we bought this hot tub and put it there and got it there, I think like 48 hours in advance so that it could, you know, get set up and heat up and all that stuff. But we got there the morning of, and it was still like the water was freezing. Like it was not.
I remember because I lived with Annie and Jimmy, Annie Hamilton and Jimmy Tatro. They moved in after Chloe and Amy left. And so I had new roommates and I was like, oh, how's this going to be? It was also fabulous. It was less like a slumber party and more like a regular party, but it was really fun.
And so, yeah, so I'm sure Annie and Jimmy were talking about this, you know, when it happened. But so we had to like manually heat up the hot tub. And so we had tons of pots and pans that were on the stove that we were like boiling water in and then bringing it over and dumping it into this hot tub to try to warm it up. And it happened to be the day that the studio and like the and some of the executive producers were visiting. And so like literally we have them helping us, like carrying pots and pans, boiling water to like warm it up. And we did get it to, we got it to, it was like in the 80s. So like it wasn't as hot as like a hot tub should technically be, but you know, they weren't
getting hypothermia. That is awesome. Chloe, how was it for you working with Jim?
It was good. Like I said, or we were talking about, he works fast, but it was really fun. We talked a lot about movies. I think we're both cinephiles at heart. So yeah, and when I wrapped, I gave him some Criterion DVDs I thought he should watch. And it was just really fun. It was like, we're both like film nerds. So talked a lot about film nerdy stuff that a lot of people have deaf ears too, but Jim's ears are wide open, loves that kind of stuff.
That's fun. Do you have a particular process or a particular way that you prepare to go into something like this?
I don't, because I think everything is every job is so different. I mean, this one, like I said, it's the angsty teenager that I have played on other shows before. So it's just like taking what I've known before, taking what I've experienced and then altering it to whatever the character is. But everyone's different. Every role requires different backpacking, if that makes sense.
So, I remember the first night. Do you remember this, like that night where the first time you worked, where you had that night shoot and like maybe you were in your underwear?
Yeah. So
it was 4 degrees and like I remember coming to set the next day and like, Chloe's like, it was fine. And then I come to set the next day and everyone's like, she was amazing. I guess, I think you sat outside in the cold for so long and you were just like, it's good. We're good.
There was one scene in the script that I was kind of anticipating. I wasn't dreading it, but I knew I just had to prep myself for it. I knew it was going to be a night shoot. It was going to be a long night. It was going to be cold. I was going to be in my underwear. So there was a lot of things going against my will. And of course, it was the first scene that I was going to shoot in this freaking movie, of course.
Where you started the scene at like 2 in the morning. It was like one of those nights.
Yes, it was. I was delirious the whole night. I can't even remember the night. Like I was put with this guy I've never met before. And next thing you know, I have to kiss him. And it was just a whole thing. And I am actually really glad it happened very early on in the shoot, because I think the whole shoot, I would have just been thinking about this scene that I would have to endure, but instead it happened right in the beginning. It was like right when I got there, I'm like, okay, this is happening.
Rip off the band-aid.
Let's just do it. And like I said, I can't really remember that night. I just remember it being very cold and being in my underwear.
I totally forgot that was your first scene. Oh my God.
It was 10 degrees. It was really cold.
I'm like, what time did you get home? She's like, 6. 12?
Yeah, I don't know. The sun was coming up. Yeah, the car that we shot in had no heat, so it was just, it was an adventure, and it was an experience unlike anything I've done before.
I mean, it sounds terrible. I'm not gonna lie. It sounds terrible.
But it only got better after that. She got the hard one out of the way, and then everything else.
It's only gonna go up.
Yeah, I was like, I can sit back and relax and just cruise the rest of this movie, because that was definitely the hard part, and it was over with very early on.
Natalie, how was that night for you?
It was a hard night. So that night we also had we had these like condors for, you know, because it's like big like nighttime shoot and we were like trying to recreate moonlight. And the condor was supposed to park in a neighbor's driveway. And it drove up onto the driveway and we didn't realize this, but they had like a drainage issue. And so their front yard was flooded, but we couldn't tell because there was snow on top of it. And the flood, it like the drainage had gone underneath the driveway. So the driveway wasn't actually on dirt or even ice. It was just on water. So the condor drove onto the driveway and immediately sunk into it. Like the driveway literally like went like this.
It made
like
a sinkhole.
Yeah, it totally. And so the condor got stuck and we had to figure out one, how to get it out, two, how to repair their driveway. It was like a very... That like all happened this like same night. And then of course we're like worried about keeping Chloe warm because like it's this tough scene where she's supposed to be outside in her underwear and it's supposed to be snowy. And so it's like, you know, trying to make sure like, you know, running up to her in between takes and like, you know, making sure she has like, you know, a heat lamp and stuff. But it was a very involved shoot. And this was also part of, that was when you did your whole stunt, right, Chloe?
Yes. Yes, like I said, I mean, so many things happened that night, a whole night of firsts.
but this is why Natalie's amazing. This is why she's like an amazing producer is because I never even heard about the thing sinking, which like should have been the first thing Chloe talked about, in which she just like I, this is my first time hearing about that. She like protected us from that. Like Chloe was just doing her scene and like the story the next day was just like, oh, it was freezing. We didn't even know about the equipment sink. Like that's a good producer who's like, yeah, you warm? Like, and she's like, ah, and then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was so cold that like, I didn't want the heat. You know, when you're just so cold that like, you just, you're numb and you're almost content. You like, don't feel like you're cold anymore. So I'm almost like, not like blankets or anything. I'm like, I'm good.
Because you can't feel your body. Like you've gone all the way.
Exactly.
I think you also had like crazy adrenaline pumping too.
Oh, Chloe. Yeah.
And you were like, just like, so I remember you just being like, yeah, let's do this. Like you were so amped and like ready to go.
Yeah. Something kicked in. Some engines were revved and I was just ready to go. I was like super energized that whole night and I was super into it. But yeah, what a weird, but everyone was so good about it. Like I had five people bringing over blankets and heating pads and like all the hand warmers, anything that I could have possibly needed, teas, coffee. So it was, I felt very catered and cared for. So that was amazing.
That's great. Riki, what stories do you have?
Well, I just remember after Chloe's first night and it being so cold, like this is like whatever, like my ears get really cold, like the inside of my, like so cold, they really do, like it's like a condition. And I remember going to set going, I think my character wears earmuffs. Yeah, great. But it was just from Chloe the night before where I was like, I feel like I wear earmuffs. Don't you think she wears earmuffs? And he's like, that's a cool idea. Yeah. And then I got to wear those every day.
Good one.
That was after Chloe's night. I don't know that I have any stories like that. Like most of my things were day shoots. It was mostly that. Like my hardest challenge, I have a really hard time memorizing lines and I get in my head about it because it's just always been my biggest challenge as an actor. It's just one of those things. It's very hard for me. And so I was freaking out a little bit, but then it all ended up being fine. So
Riki also was like such a trooper. We have this scene where she and Jim are in this like cop car together and they're, you know, having this like back and forth and it's, you know, a very involved back and forth. And, you know, these cop cars aren't very big. You know, we had this like big camera rig in there. And so there were like some times where like Riki had to like be in like the cop car and there's like this like rig around her and she has to like look completely casual and like get, you know, give these lines as if she's not like smushed inside of the car. And she did it flawlessly. Like it's like so good in, you know, in the movie, and you would never know that like there's like things sticking out like everywhere around her.
It's so funny. I had my lines like on my lap. The day I got there, I made best friends with the PA and I was like, I'm bad at lines. Like, how can you help me? And she like got me, like, she would always find me an area. The day I got there, she found me like that weird office. Like I always had. And then the one day when I didn't have an office, she's like, you're going to sit in my car and work on your lines. And I was like, thank you. So I sat in the PA's car. They just like really took care of me. Like, and then, yeah. And then, yeah. And then I would have my lines like down there so I could look at them and then like bend around a weird camera.
Okay. So in this weird time of pandemic and civil chaos and everything else we're living through at the moment, where are we going to be able to see this movie?
It'll be in 100 theaters around the country. So a lot of drive-ins, but also some regular ones. So if it's playing at your local theater, and if you have a drive-in that's near you that you want to make sure that it plays there, let us know. Email info@vanishingangle.com and we'll try to make sure that It plays at all the drive-in theaters near where our fans are. And then it'll also be available on iTunes and, you know, all the normal places where you can buy movies.
So you can stream it also? You don't have to go venture out. I mean,
yes, you can either watch it from the comfort of your home, or if you want to go super retro and, you know, drive in your car, you can also do that. We have a screening. The world premiere is happening at Beyond Fest October 2nd in LA, and they're doing it at the Mission Tiki Drive-In.
The Mission Tiki Drive-In, so much. If anyone is listening, you have to go there. It's a really, really fun experience. I love the Mission Tiki.
I went there a couple weeks ago. It was so cute.
I'm really excited about it. They can fit 300 cars, and we sold out our screening in like a couple hours. So it's, people seem, you know, really excited about it. We're doing it as a double feature with The Burbs, which we're really excited about. The Burbs is one of Jim's favorite movies, and he kept on talking about it as we were shooting this movie, and he talked about it so much. Then when we got back to LA, I'm like, okay, fine. I'm going to watch The Burbs because Jim won't shut up about this movie. And I watched it and it's so great.
Is it that Michael Keaton movie?
With like Tom Hanks, you know.
I don't think I've seen it. I have to watch it.
Or it's not the Hitchcock Birds?
Oh, you're thinking The Birds. She said The Burbs, like the suburbs, right?
Burbs. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, I'm thinking The Birds and I'm into it.
Jim also loves Hitchcock, but yeah.
He's into The Birds. Such a niche, interesting choice. Okay.
Like, that makes sense.
Yeah. I need to see The Birds now. That sounds good.
Yeah, it's fun. It's like Tom Hanks is directed by Joe Dante, and it's this like, you know, kind of, you know, horror comedy, you know, very much kind of walking that fine line that I think Jim does in this film. And so when MGM asked him, you know, like what would be a movie that you would want to pair with this, and he was like The Burbs. So yeah, but it'll be available in a bunch of theaters around the country. So if you want to go to a drive-in, you know, be safe, wear your mask, but, you know, or, you know, go to a theater, but wear a mask, or watch it from the comfort of your home.
That is so great. Now, I would love to hear what else you guys are all working on right now, if you're even able to, because I know it's such a crazy time to be working on projects.
I'm on a show called Duncanville. It's on Fox. It's an Amy Poehler, Ty Burrell show. Yeah, we got picked up for season 2. So I've been doing that. Yeah. And then I'm also writing an animated movie, and they haven't announced it yet. So I don't watch. Hopefully they'll announce it soon, because I sold it a long time ago, but I'm writing this animated musical. It's like sort of in the style of Frozen, I guess. But I thought of it last year during filming this movie, because I had like a couple some days off, and I was in this cabin alone, because Chloe and I would be filming separately. So I'd be in this cabin alone, and like I couldn't go anywhere. And so I just thought of this whole movie, and then we ended up selling it. And so I'm writing that. So
great.
That's awesome. I totally remember that whole process.
Yeah, I know that
you got Duncanville as we were shooting.
Yes.
It was just a totally unexpected kind of thing, but
so
I
totally awesome.
Remember that. And now look at, you're already on season 2. You got picked up for season 2. That's awesome.
There you go. Yeah.
That's so cool.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Chloe? Anything in the hopper?
I am working on an HBO show right now. It's called Generation. And so we shot the pilot last year, and we are just now getting back into production. Actually, this is our first week of shooting, so I'm back in the saddle. I've been anticipating finishing up this show. We were supposed to start in June, but then COVID and everything. So I'm just happy we're back shooting again. It's a whole different process, and there's all these different procedures and precautions that they have to go step over before shooting, but we're all clear. I get tests 3 times a week, and it's going to be, I hope the shoot goes well, but yeah, that's for HBO. It's called Generation.
That's great. Can you talk a little, have you been to set yet? You started shooting?
So the shooting starts this week. My first day is on Thursday, but we've been rehearsing at the studios for the last 2 weeks.
So tell us a little bit about how the protocols are working. Like, I've heard about it from a crew perspective, but as an actor, how, because, you know, everybody is protecting you, right? So how is that? You say you're getting tested 3 times a week, and what else do you have to do?
Well, there are different tiers. Like, I'm in the red zone. There's like orange zone, just depending on your position on the show. So you have cast, you have crew, grips, whatever. And each tier has a different amount of times that they get tested a week and different areas that they can go into. So everything's mapped up. It's really new to me as well. I can just speak on when we were rehearsing. Even so, it's like your mask is on, you're 6 feet, 6 to 8 feet apart from each other. Hair and makeup, it's the same thing. They wear full on hazmat suits and they have shields and masks. It's very, very protective. And yeah, the only time that I really took my mask off was when we were doing the hair and makeup test and I got touched up. But it's going to be, I can't really speak on the shoot because this is literally day one. It's Monday today. This is day one of the shoot. So I'll have to check in and see how it went. But I'm pretty sure it's like you keep your mask on right before action, you could take it off, and then right at cut you put it back on, and it's just a whole different way of shooting. And it's amazing that they figured out, they finessed the system and they got productions off the ground. But it's weird to be a part of it. I didn't think I'd be a part of one of like the first ones that are going. So, and it's like, it's happening in Los Angeles too, like a very, very COVID heavy area, but they
figured
out how to do it.
Okay, be really safe. And also because we all want our television.
Yeah, I know.
Natalie, I know you always have 100 oars in the water. What are you doing?
Well, so we just wrapped production on our newest movie, which is very strangely also a werewolf movie, but completely different. It's called Werewolves Within. We partnered with Ubisoft, the video game company. It's based off of their game, but it's like very much, it's like more comedy than horror. It's very funny, starring Sam Richardson and Milana Ventrob. And yeah, we actually wrapped that March 10th. So like just days before the lockdown, we were upstate New York from January 5th through March 10th. We were so lucky with how the schedule timed out, and we were able to get it all in the can before, you know, lockdown. And so we've been in post-production on that for the past several months. Post has been able to be done remotely, which has been great. And we actually just finished the film and are starting to, you know, take it out to sales agents and starting to have those conversations and submitting to festivals and all of that stuff, which we're excited about. And then we're in post-production on Jim's newest movie because Jim doesn't stop. And so his movie following this up is a film called The Beta Test, which we shot in November and that he's still editing together. And yeah, and then we have a couple different projects in development, you know, one that's supposed to shoot November, December. So we'll see. It's been greenlit and ready to go. We're just making sure everything is, you know, COVID friendly. And yeah, and then we have a sci-fi thriller that I wrote that we're getting off the ground. And yeah, a couple other projects.
Woo-hoo. God, so exciting. You guys are all doing it. Do you want to say where we can find you or follow you? I know you're not on TikTok.
I'm at Riki Lindhome on Twitter and Instagram.
And it's R-I-K-I.
Mm-hmm. And I am at Chloe East on Instagram. And I don't have a Twitter. I believe my Twitter was shut down or hacked or something. But I am on Instagram at Chloe East.
What did you say on Twitter?
I think I was editing my profile and I tried to change my birthday. Because, of course, when you first make your Twitter, when you're 8, you put in a different birthday. So when I went to change back to my actual birthday, which I am old enough to be on Twitter, thank you very much, it shut me down. They said you're a fraud or something like that. So I'm not on Twitter anymore.
Sorry. And I'm at Natalie Metzger on Instagram and at MetzArt on Twitter. And you can also follow the movie. It's The Wolf of Snow Hollow. I think it's at The Wolf of Snow Hollow on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. But yeah, check out our movie on October 9th.
It's called The Wolf of Snow Hollow. Did everybody get that? Go watch it. Thanks, you guys. This was so fun.
Thank you for having us.
You've been listening to The Other 50%, A Herstory of Hollywood. I'm Julie Harris Walker. I'd like to thank Natalie Metzger, Riki Lindhome, and Chloe East for sharing their stories. And special thanks to Jay Rowe, Danny Rosner, and Allison McQuaid for the music. Please find us on your favorite podcast provider and leave a review. And of course, on our website, theother50percent.com, all spelled out in letters, for added features, bios of our guests, and the merch. You can also follow us on all the social media platforms. Thanks for listening. See you next time.